भारत
Big start. Now.
Yes.
Namaste Bharat. My name is Zinal Shah and today's webinar is being hosted by me. Today we have speaker Rishi Bhuta, Advocate Bombay High Court, and he will be speaking on today's topic, that is law as regards to abetment of suicide, presumption as to death of married women, and punishment for attempt to commit suicide. Now I hand over the session to Sri Rishi sir for enlightening us on his vast topic and experience on the said topic. Thank you.
Shall I take it over?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good evening, friends. Before I begin, I hope everybody has gone through the notes and I have received the notes. But that would be quite helpful in what I would be saying, because the topic is too sensitive, touchy, and I cannot extend beyond much whatever is written in the notes. It's not a topic to be made fun of or quote unquote anybody who is not in this world. Rather, they have to be respected, and more so, it's a short topic which needs to be covered very crisply. First of all, beginning with a thank you note, thank you Siddharth very much for hosting this second webinar and giving me and my team and my colleagues and friends a chance to come before all the viewers. Thank you my seniors for approving the notes, for correcting them, and so that it could reach all the viewers here. And last of all, thank you Simran for helping me in pasting and editing some quotes from internet and helping me with the notes. To start with, let us see a few names which possibly everybody knows here. The names are Robin Williams, Marilyn Monroe, Jia Khan, Nafisa Joseph, a latest Joy Arakel, Silk Smita, and many more. These people had all the fan followings, fame, name, crowd pullers in their own distinct sense, and everybody who followed them or who was in awe of them felt that their lives are wonderful. Nothing can ever be compared to what they live, and everybody wanted to step into their shoes. But all these people and many others who have not named, top personalities and many others, had one thing in common. The common thing was that they all died. The death was due to suicide. What is a suicide? Su means self, side means killing. It is self-killing. Sometimes we don't understand what goes on beyond these famous personalities. At the outer side, they look to be so happy and free from all the troubles and depressions and all the shortcomings of the life. But only when they take this drastic step, at that point of time, they become the gossip mills of the next day's newspapers and amongst the common man to discuss. Oh, the reality was this. It was that. He was living in such a depression. He was a bankrupt, and we thought that he's a great man. So by doing this, we cast a stigma upon their deaths. It is not that. Suicide is not an easy thing, because a person who commits suicide does not ever do in hope of a noble postmortem or attending the heaven. He does it because he feels that death is an easier version than the worst evil of a life. Also, sometimes it happens that a person is unable to take pressure of his struggles, depression, or other problems, and he feels that it is better he leaves this world and goes into the next world rather than suffer the pain, agony. Before I begin the topic, let us take an example of Cafe Coffee Day owner Siddharth. He was short of nothing. He was related to a political family. He came from a business family. He had coffee plantations all over Bangalore, Karnataka rather. And still, whenever his stories were put forth by the media on the Business Today, Time magazines, Forbes magazines, he was projected as one of the most successful individuals in India ever. The chain of Cafe Coffee Day was a dream chain. It was being compared to Starbucks and Tim Hortons and many other all over the world. And suddenly what we read one fine day, that Siddharth goes on a bridge and commits suicide. The reasons was that he writes down in his suicide letter is that he was unable to cope up with the pressure coming from the income tax authorities. So my friend, despite outward appearances, famous suicides of famous people are not always that great as is portrayed by those living. It's always something different. Their lives are also like our lives, but unfortunately, they cannot cope up with the depression, marital problems, bankruptcy, and other issues. Now let's come to another issue. Suicide is the 10th most reason of deaths in this entire world. There are 195 countries in the world. Now out of 195, a question arises that India has on an average, right from 2016 till 2020, on an average, there are between 2.15 lakhs to 2.40 lakhs death a year. But we still stand on a scale of 21st in the world on the graphic scale of suicides. The number one country is Eastern Europe, Lithuania. And last is the West Indian island of Antigua and Barbados. So it would not be easier to Japan, South Korea, China rank much higher than us, possibly 14, 17 and 18. In South Korea, there's a bridge called Bridge of Suicide. Because in South Korea, the elderly people have a tendency developed when they are not looked after by the younger generation to go on this bridge of suicide and commit suicide. China, I read it somewhere, though it's a very, very drastic step, that to curb its suicidal tendencies of its people, put in a rule, as a communist country, it can put anything, put in a rule that if any member of the family commits suicide, then all the wages, employment, education of the surviving members will be struck off. The surviving family will have to bear the brunt of staying as bankrupt and rather isolated from the entire community. This step of the Chinese government drastically helped in curbing suicides, and from number 5, they came to number 14, 15. Now, what is a suicide in an Indian penal code? The word suicide is nowhere explained. As I said, at the cost of repetition, it is self-killing. Now, Section 306 was engrafted in Indian Penal Code because of an existing prevailing custom in India of sati. Onkarnath's judgment, Onkarnath versus State of Rajasthan, of 1978 judgment, ultimately saw the light in 1987. And subsequently, those abetting a woman who has lost her husband to sit on the funeral pyre were found guilty of an abatement of suicide. The term abatement is defined in 307 and 108, which I will talk later on. First, let us deal with Section 306, which defines abatement of suicide. Whoever abates the commission of suicide shall be punished with imprisonment for a period of up to 10 years and fine. Now, this definition of abatement is that abatement means instigation, mens rea, goading, and prompting a person to go and die. A decorated judgment of Apex Court in Madan Mohan Singh, Sanju Sengar of 2002 has said that the words saying go and die will not amount to suicide. Something more positive is required than mere assertion of words of saying go and die. A recent judgment of Calcutta High Court, which was carried forward to Honorable Apex Court in Indrajit Kundu's matter of 2019-20, where it was held, a mother filed an appeal against the acquittal by the higher courts and the lower courts, stating that her daughter was characterized on herself and said as call girl. And because of this statement by the in-laws that the daughter-in-law is a call girl, she had to take the drastic step of ending her life. Honorable Apex Court said that the word call girl itself would amount to a defamation. But if by saying the words call girl, the victim who ends a life, normally such victims have to be considered as hypersensitive to ordinary prudence of lives. And more so, they are unable to bear the agony and pain and caused at their near and dear ones. But this does not mean that there is an abatement, there is an instigation, there is a mens rea, there is a goading, there is a conspiracy to see that the victim commits suicide. Now, an abatement of suicide is punishable under 306. Friends, listeners, my personal experience is that 306 is a very misguided section. What happens when a person leaves a suicide note? And let's say an example of a moneylender who gives loans to various people. Definitely, he will pursue taking back those loans. when he pursues taking back those loans, it happens that some people unable to pay the loans either tend to shy away from paying the loans, declare themselves bankrupt. But in some events, people are unable to take that pressure of the moneylender being after them, and in a drastic measure of stress, they commit suicide. I'll leave behind a suicide note. I had dealt with such a case. I'll leave behind a suicide note stating that this person I had borrowed money from, but now he has threatened me of dire consequences if I don't pay the money. So having no other option, I have to commit suicide and leave my near and dear ones. In such an event, definitely the police has to take an FIR because there's a suicide note. But ultimately, my friends, on 100 or 100 counts, such a FIR would either be quashed or the accused would be discharged. And if the accused faces trial, it is bound to end in an acquittal, because all judgments which I have dealt with in my notes, which I'm going to quote it before you listeners, would be on one point itself, that there should be an abatement, instigation, something more is required from mere assertion of words or speaking of words. Just by saying that I will see that if you don't make me my payments, I will kill you, even does not amount to an instigation for an abatement of suicide act to take place. No doubt it is the incumbent, as in my last webinar, I had said that upon receipt of a cognizable offense, police are bound under 154. But issue is that if police are bound under 154, courts cannot be overzealous in protecting the complainant because he has lost his life, or the near and dear ones of the complainant have lost their lives. Ultimately, justice has to be done, because the mandatory provisions of abatement as per section 107 is instigation, entering into criminal conspiracy, and to do that thing. Mens rea is one of the most essential ingredients of an abatement to suicide. Here I am discarding 113A of Evidence Act for a minute. We will discuss that, because that applies only to married women. And also for a moment, I am not touching to 108, who is an abettor. But the issue here is that I would, if I could quote 8 judgments, which are all possibly not a part of my written notes, right from Sanju Sengar, Orilal Jaiswal, Netai Datta, Madan Mohan Singh, Indrajit Kundu, Swami Pralad Das, and Anaga Arya of our Bombay High Court. Now, Anaga Arya is something different case, which I also read it first in point of time in my entire career of 20, spanning to over 22 years. Anaga Arya was a case where the husband committed suicide. The sister of the husband lodged an FIR against the wife, saying that the husband committed suicide because of the marital problems and because the wife had an extramarital affair with one of the husband's friends. And subsequently, during the course of investigation, was transpired that the wife and the friend of that husband used to have phone sex, used to exchange pornography views, and subsequently it was transpired by the husband, discovered by the husband, which ultimately led to his demise. Ladyship Justice Bhatkar, while discharging the accused in a challenge to a rejection of a discharge, while discharging the accused, observed that phone sex could be a crime under any other laws, but just by, because the wife is having phone sex or sharing pornography details or sharing her naked or semi-naked photos, would not itself amount that the wife, by, because of such an act, has instigated, abated, or had mens rea for the husband to commit such a crime. It was much open to the husband to file cases of bigamy, file a divorce case. Taking this drastic step definitely was an unfortunate act. But ultimately, the accused was discharged because the ingredients of 306 coupled with 107 was not proved. She was not an abettor to this crime. An abettor is the one who directly or indirectly causes the act to happen, or if not would have happened, is one of the participants to that act. Now, section 306, in all the judgments that I have relied upon, my friends, today I will be harping more on judgments, because apart from the famous personalities which I dealt with, that would be an academic lecture. Which countries is affected by what is not our concern here. Here our concern is that why do people commit suicide, and what is the legal impediments of the Indian Penal Code, Evidence Act, in dealing, and our judiciary in dealing with the objectives of suicide. As I said earlier, as in my personal view also, which is also a part of the notes, that more or less the cases of suicide, if it reaches the trial, end in an acquittal. unless there is an abatement, incitement, guilty mind, mens rea, or something more than mere utterance of words, then only a case of 306 IPC can be proved, failing which the case could be filed because there is a death, but it won't survive in the courts of law by no stretch of imagination. Ultimately, what transpires is that an accused goes through the ordeal of an entire trial for years together. Recently, in our case in Dindoshi, we had an acquittal of an accused and his friend. The case was that, now this is something personal I would talk, which went on for 15 years. The crime was registered in 2005 by the brother of the deceased, stating that the accused had extramarital affairs with the deceased, and ultimately upon questioning him, he refused to marry. And subsequently, accused number two threatened the deceased that do whatever you want, we are powerful people, nobody can touch us. Subsequently, finding no other options, she strangulated herself, and thereafter an FIR was lodged in 2005. The accused was in custody for 65 days. Accused number two was on anticipatory bail, but ultimately in 2019, August, both the accused were honorably acquitted by Honorable Sessions Court at Dindoshi, stating that even though the death is unfortunate, there is no mens rea, guilty mind, instigation, abatement. Having extramarital affairs would itself do not mean that the person has to marry. The victim was major. She was duty bound to know the consequences of her act. Here I'm not talking at the language of 376, but this is the observation where the number of judgments were relied upon us. This is an observation in Indrajit Kundu's case also. The victim could be hypersensitive, emotional, and gullible to surroundings upon her, which she is unable to take. As I said, that people sometimes feel that rather than living this wretch life, it is better that we die and go. But as if you all read the last three lines of my notes and the last page, it's not the pain that they get. It is the pain that they leave behind to their near and dear ones. And ultimately, that is an unsolved mystery as to why the person took this drastic step, why he could not talk to the family members, what was that urgency that on that fateful day, evening or night, he had to commit suicide. These answers are unsolved. That is why if my Roman 1 topic is seen, why do people kill themselves? No psychiatrists, doctors or top authors can solve this problem, could find an answer. Ultimately, the answers that were found was that depression is one of the biggest causes, stress, bankruptcy, marital problems, social problems, extramarital affairs, and stress from work and at home. In Siddhartha's case of CCD, he has explained in his suicide note that he could not take the stress from income tax authorities and his company was suffering a loss. Imagine if a man running CCD from 1996 commits suicide after 23 years of building up such a magnitude of an empire, leaving behind nobody to take care of that. Because if it's within my knowledge, even the shares of CCD are not being traded now in the stock exchange. See what has happened because of this one drastic step. It is not that the income tax problems could have arisen for the first time in 23 years. It is not that there could not have been a bad planning, but he chose to take this drastic step. Honorable ex-Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh, Mr. Pul, committed suicide when his government was dismissed by Honorable Apex Court. And thereafter, after suicide and after his funeral, a 60-page suicide note was found from his bedroom, blaming, though it would be a controversial issue, blaming Honorable Supreme Court judges, blaming Congress spokespersons, blaming all the top honkers of Delhi. And ultimately, the writ petition filed by his wife was thrown up at that time, saying that this is not a case of instigation abatement. And if a man writes a 60-page suicide note, then he's in a proper state of mind. He's in a complete hell-bent mode of revenge. And he has ended his life with a view to take revenge upon all those people who have possibly or not wronged him. So this is the impact of a suicide note. It's not that by this, I don't mean that all suicide notes are wrong. Sometimes convictions are indeed based upon suicide notes. If the background indeed was bad, if the person was subjected to harassment, torture or coercion or pressure or an assault, And thereafter, in those circumstances, if he writes a suicide note against a person that I'm taking this drastic step of ending my life because I cannot bear this pain from this man or a woman or any other person in the community, or I cannot bear the social stigma that he has imposed me upon, then there is no other option. In such a case, a conviction has to take place. The man has to see the light at the end of the day and go to jail, because all the ingredients are proved. The instigation is proved. The abetment is proved. The mens rea is proved. The guilty mind is proved. The conspiracy, if any one or more persons are involved, is proved. So all the ingredients which are required are left unturned, and the court can arrive at a conclusion in such a view that the man is guilty of abetment to suicide coupled with 107 and 108. There is no separate punishment for section 107 or section 108. The punishment is coupled with 306. When an FIR is raised under 306, the normal course of a police is to go and arrest. But if by any reason the police does not arrest that person, the person has an option, the accused has an option of dealing with going for an anticipatory bail, going for bail. In such an event, bail cannot be granted by the lower courts. Here, by lower courts, I mean that bail cannot be granted by magistrates' courts, JMFC courts, because the offense is sessions triable, punishable up to 10 years. Bail can only be granted by Honorable Sessions Court, if not Honorable High Court, and if not, then Honorable Apex Court. Charge sheet in such an event has to be filed before the Honorable Learned Magistrates Court where the remand goes, because it's not a special act where the remand has to travel to the Sessions Court. It's an act where the accused has to be arrested, produced before the learned JMFC or the Magistrates Court within 24 hours as per the mandate of CRPC, and then once charge sheet is filed, if he's still in custody, the case has to be committed and the trial has to be tried by the Honorable Sessions Court. In this case, the mandatory period, as I discussed in my last webinar, to file the charge sheet is 60 days because the offense is punishable with up to 10 years. Up to 10 years, as per 167.2A1, the mandatory period, if the accused is in custody, is 60 days, not beyond that. If there is a default of filing the charge sheet within 60 days, then the accused has to get mandatory bail. Now, this was just a minor explanation of the procedure and the remand part and the bail part. But again, coming back to 306, 107, 108. As I said, 306 is the punishment offense. 107 and 108 cling to 306 because for proving a case under 306, the abetment is required, instigation is required, guilty mind is required, mens rea is required, and something more than words or saying of the things is required. As I said, mere utterance of go and die, ja ja ke mar ja, it doesn't make any effect on me. I am least concerned, I am a powerful man. Such words, if the victim takes it seriously, cannot ever end into a conviction. Rather, there are cases where the accused has been discharged or the cases have been quashed in such a case. Now coming to another section of Evidence Act, that is 113A of Evidence Act. 113A was specially carved out in the Evidence Act in 1983, but it has a retrospective effect in the sense that if an offense has taken place in 1970, let's say, I'm going as old as 1970. If an offense has taken place in 1970, then also during the course of the trial, the retrospective act of 1983, 113A would be applicable to the trial conducted even though the CR is of 1970. Now 113A only applies to married women, that too who have committed suicide. Listeners, this is a very important section. This has its own repercussions. The punishment could shift on various counts. It could even go to 304B or 302. Why I say so? Because 113A only applies to married women. At the sake of repetition, I'm saying that. That too, if she commits a suicide at the cruelty suffered at the hands of her husband or relative of the husband within 7 years from the date of marriage. Now, this is a mandatory provision that the cruelty should be implicated upon the wife by the husband or the relatives of the husband within 7 years. If an offense of suicide of a wife takes place within after 7 years from the date of marriage, and if the wife leaves a suicide note or implicates the husband and the relatives of the husband in that suicide, then section 113A cannot be used, because it is very restrictively worded that if the offense takes place within 7 years from the date of marriage. If it's 7 years and one day, the courts cannot overlook this provision and use the presumption of 113A. Now, 113A itself casts no punishment upon the accused. It's a presumption to be used. I would be repeating. Please pardon me for repeating, because this is a very, very important presumption grafted in the Indian Evidence Act by our constitution, that the suicide should be by a wife. If the suicide is by a girlfriend or a living partner or by a person or by a woman who is in extramarital affair with the husband, 113A cannot be used. 113A is only for women, and that too for a wife who has suffered cruelty and has taken the drastic step of committing suicide within 7 years of her marriage. If the offense is committed after 7 years of the marriage, an offense of 306 would definitely lie, but the courts cannot use presumption of 113A. This is mandatory. Now, 113A is retrospective in nature. Honorable Division Bench of Calcutta High Court in 1989, in Anil Kumar's judgment, has clearly meted out why it is retrospective, why it needs to be strictly followed, and why the mandatory period of 7 years cannot be bypassed, extended under any circumstances. 1989 judgment of Division Bench of Calcutta High Court is very clear on this. The retrospective effect has got no presumption of years. It can be 1950, 60, 70, 80, up till 83. After 83, it is mandatory bound to be followed. But 113A is retrospective in nature. It applies to a lady. The lady should be a wife. She should have suffered cruelty at the hands of the husband or the relatives of the husband. Here, shifting from 113A for a minute, here the term cruelty, as all my listeners and viewers would know, that the term cruelty is to be on the same scale as is defined in 498A, which relates to cruelty by the husband or the relatives of the husband to the wife. The cruelty should be of such a nature that the wife is left with no other option save and except to commit suicide. Then the presumption would succeed, but it should be within 7 years. If it crosses 7 years, it would come in the definition of cruelty, but presumption cannot be used to nail the accused, if any. Now, 113B pertains to dowry then, which we are not concerned here today, but that's a presumption under dowry then. Subsequently, during the course of a trial of 306 coupled with 113A, if it's found to the court that the cruelty was of nature in regard to dowry, all cruelty sometimes does not pertain to dowry. Sometimes alcohol is one of the reasons of cruelty. Sometimes extramarital affair is one of the reasons of cruelty. Sometimes depression, personal issues, work problems are reasons of cruelty, which the man removes his frustration at home and the in-laws join the chorus in assaulting or committing cruelty upon the wife or in taunting. But if the court during the course of a trial finds that the cruelty was in relation to dowry and which was in immediate nature, prior to the wife committing suicide, then even if the no charge is framed under 306, if the no charge is framed under 304B and the trial is completely for 306, the accused can be convicted for 304B IPC and the punishment is much severe and it goes to life. The accused cannot raise a plea that no charge was explained. Charge can be altered, amended, added, deleted at any stage of the trial. Only mandatory condition is that the judgment should not have been pronounced. So here, drifting apart, why did I raise this issue of 113B is because if during the course of a trial of 306, read with 113A of Evidence Act, the prosecution is able to prove that the cruelty was in nature of dowry demand. And because of that, the woman prior to committing suicide was immediately subjected to harassment, torture, assault, due to which she had no other alternative save and except to take this drastic step of committing suicide, then the court can convict the accused under 304B, even though no charge is framed under 304B and the entire trial goes for an offense of 306. Now, let's come to an issue where a person tries to commit suicide. And in that process, he does not die, but due to some miraculous attempt on the part of his family, friends, well-wishers, he's saved as they take him to an hospital or treatment is administered to him or the attempt fails. In such an event, our IPC has engrafted a section 309, punishment for attempt to commit suicide. Now, this punishment is only for 1 year, but this punishment is engrafted to create a pressure upon the accused, upon the person who tried to commit suicide. Here he would be accused, deemed accused, because he has been saved from his attempt to commit suicide. So the law says that such a person, because he tried to commit suicide, has to be punished. The punishment has to be for a period of 1 year. But our constitution, time and again, our apex court, rather I'll come to the constitution later on, time and again, it starts from Honorable Division Bench of Bombay High Court in 1986 judgment, where section 309 was declared as unconstitutional. And it was observed in P. Ratinam's judgment of Apex Court in 1994 that if there is a right to live as per Article 21, then there should be a right to die. So Section 309 is unconstitutional and cannot be implemented upon, even though the victim oblique accused, now if 309 is implied, survives. Lot of harakiri started taking place because Honorable Apex Court 2 bench judgment came out with P. Ratinam's judgment that Section 309 is unconstitutional in nature and all deemed cases were sought to be quashed. A 5 bench judgment sitting in Gyan Kaur in 1996 while dealing in an appeal from Punjab of Section 306, where the father-in-law, mother-in-law and the husband were convicted for an offence of 306 for abetting the suicide of a wife, raised the constitutional question that if a person has a right to live, then he has a right to die. The defense was that she committed suicide. There was nothing on record that the accused instigated, abetted, or had menstrual, that the deceased should commit suicide. Now, question arose before the constitutional bench, 5 bench in Gyan Kaur's case was that right to live does not mean right to die. It means only right to live. Ratinam's judgment was overruled. Bombay High Court's judgment was overruled and Apex Court ultimately agreed with the judgment of Andhra Pradesh Division Bench, which took the same view which Gyan Kaur's judgment in 1996 had taken. Ultimately, they left it to the wisdom of the Constitution that if the makers of the Constitution feel it dim and proper, then they can scrap 309 or amend it. From 1996 till 2014, no steps were taken by the Constitution up till Aruna Shanbhag's judgment in 2014, para 104, which deals with the case of passive euthanasia. Just drifting for a minute and coming back to Aruna Shanbhag. Aruna Shanbhag is the same nurse who was chained for 24 years in St. George's Hospital at Mahalakshmi, where she was gang-raped and she suffered emotional trauma and had practically, after all treatment, given up her hopes of life. So, on behalf of Union for People's Civil Liberties, a petition was filed first in Bombay High Court, then in Apex Court for administering active euthanasia. Since Honorable Bombay High Court rejected that challenge, Honorable Apex Court dealt with that challenge and said that active euthanasia is completely ruled out, though making out an exception and carving out an exception, passive euthanasia could be resorted to, looking to her condition, but under guidelines prescribed in para 101 of Aruna Shanbhag's case. Now, in this case also, while dealing with 309, the Aruna Shanbhag's case does not scrap 309, but ultimately deals a note of caution to the constitution makers that 309 is merely punishing a person who is already disturbed, depressed, stressed, and has lost all the interest in the world. And ultimately, it will lead to the burden of the courts. And left it as a reminder back to the constitution that look, 309 section can be dealt with. It is advisable to scrap it. It does not mean that either Gyan Kaur's judgment or Aruna Shanbhag's judgment dealt with or approved the theory, rationalism, or the basis of Rathinam's judgment. Rathinam's judgment was a judgment which gave an equal platform of right to live, right to die. If a person has a right to breathe, he has a right to stop that breathing, his own. So that was completely wavered. Gyan Kaur criticized that board, that acceptance, that theory, that observations, and was completely disregarded. From 2014, now, till today, the 309 has not been scrapped. It still is a punishable offense. Before touching to what is the further issues, why 309 was brought into picture? 309 was brought into picture because of two things. One, because of Santhara religion in Jain community, where the monks used to do fast into them. So ultimately finding that people were doing, respected monks were doing fast into death, which itself mounted as an parallelly seen as an attempt to commit suicide. And ultimately, when they are fasting into death, instigated by members of the community, an offense of 309 would lie against the man or the monk who's doing fast into death and aiding and abetting that fast into death. So 306 and 309. So ultimately, in Nikhil Soni's case, Division Bench of Rajasthan High Court laid down guidelines that fast unto death, that is Santhara, is banned. A monk cannot resort to fast unto death. And if he resorts, that practice has to be stopped immediately upon the knowledge of the administration coming to that a monk is doing fast unto death. But still, Nikhil Soni's judgment of the Division Bench of Rajasthan High Court does not deal with whether that monk should be punished or not. It leaves it to the wisdom of the constitution. Now, constitution from 1996 till 2014 was silent on this. From 2014 till 2020 also, there is no judgment which deals with abolition of section 309 or how to deal with section 309. Nobody wants to touch this delicate issue. But ultimately, Mental Illness Act of 2017 carves out a section 115 of that 115 of that act, which says that if a person tries to commit suicide as per the definition of section 309, then that person will be deemed to be in stress and no punishment should be prescribed for it. So it does not abolish, it cannot abolish, but it deals that all the persons who attempt to commit suicide and are saved will be considered as persons with stress. So as on today, even though a person attempts to commit suicide and is fortunately saved due to some divine intervention or the help of the near and dear ones or by the doctors, he would come under the category of Mental Illness Act Section 115, Mental Illness Act 2017 Section 115, and would be classified as a person with severe stress, who needs treatment, who needs psychiatric treatment, and who needs to be cared for and loved for. My listeners, today, since I dealt with Section 306, 107, 108, 113A presumption, and the practice of Sati, why 306 was brought into picture because of Onkar Nath's judgment, that Sati was being instigated, aided and abated. So to abolish the practice of Sati, the law of 306 practically started. Now, I would touch a few relevant decorated judgments of our Honorable Apex Court, where in two judgments which I would touch is that Sanju Sengar versus State of Madhya Pradesh and Swami Prahlad Das versus State of Madhya Pradesh again. In these two judgments, Swami Prahlad Das is of 1995, Sanju Sengar is of 2002. In these two situations, what had transpired is that on the facts and circumstances, the utterance of the word go and die were given importance by the trial court judges and a conviction was based upon that the moment you say go and die to a person who's hypersensitive, emotional in nature, and he takes this drastic step, you have practically instigated the abatement of that step in allowing the person to commit suicide. Unfortunately, this is not the correct case and which finds its wisdom in Honorable Apex Court's judgment, which says that even if a person says go and die, the real meaning assertion should be found out in what circumstances he mean that. Sometimes a person in a state of angerness or in a state of his own problems would say, go and damn, he's bothered with your existence. Does this mean that he is incited? He has done a mens rea, he has a motive, he has done an abetment to cause the death of that person, or he really mean these words? The Honorable Apex Court, while setting aside the conviction in both these cases, has observed that something more passive is required than mere utterance of words. As I said in Anaga's case, Justice Bhatkar said that even if pending pawn cases or phone sex, discovery of the husband, remedies were available. If he commits suicide, it would not amount to abetment, incitement, mens rea, guilty mind. As I said in Indrajit Kundu's judgment of a Supreme Court, where the victim was said with unparliamentary language. She could not take that language coming from her husband and her in-laws and near and dear ones. Ultimately, Apex Court said that the language is deprecable, but this language itself, the woman could be hypersensitive, emotional cord in nature, and she could not have taken this language. But this does not mean that the person has to stand the ordeal of a conviction or even face a trial under 306. Now there are few judgments from West Bengal. Netaji Dutta's judgment, Orilal Jaiswal, and other, even Indrajit Kuddu's judgment travel from West Bengal, which deals with suicide notes. If a person, by taking a drastic step, writes in the suicide note that I'm fed up of the harassment done by him, or I'm fed up of this money lender, or I'm fed up of my boss, he harasses me, he doesn't grant me leave, he makes me work more hard, or he doesn't pay me much more, would all these factors come under the definition of instigation, abetment, or mens rea, or guilty mind, that the person, if he makes somebody to work more, doesn't pay him more, or harasses him during workplace, would all these be a term as an abetment to society? The Honorable Apex Court, dealing with all these cases, answered in clear terms that no, this cannot be termed as suicide. This can only be termed as one of the reasons that the person who said all these words could be not in a proper state of mind, and the person who believed this word that go and die and written all this in the suicide notes could be in a troubled state of mind, could be in an emotional trauma, and could not take this word. So my friends, summarizing the entire webinar of 306, 107, 108, 130A of Presumption Act and 309 of IPC, the main ingredients, at the sake of repetition, the main ingredients should be that there should be an abatement with the definition of 107. There should be an abater as per the definition of 108 IPC. There should be instigation as per clause 1 as of 107. There should be a criminal conspiracy with one or more persons as per clause 2 of 107. And there should be guilty mind as per clause 3 of 107. Only if all these ingredients are satisfied, are complied with, then the test of trial can take place. Otherwise, in innumerable number of cases which I have relied upon in my notes, the petitions are allowed, the FIRs are quashed, and the accused are either discharged or acquitted. Subsequently, because of the prevailing practice of sati, I would repeat again, because of the prevailing practice of sati, section 306 came in to be drafted in the Indian Penal Code to stop this practice. Because the aiding and abetting was much prevalent in sati. Though the first recorded case of suicide was in 454 BC in Greek, where the person jumped to death. Second, then 309 is still alive and active, though in numerous judgments ranging from Gyan Kaur till of 1996 till Aruna Shanbagh in 2014, para 104. Then the five bench judges of Honorable Apex Court have made a recommendation to the constitution makers to scrap 309. But ultimately, the Mental Illness Act of 2017 came into picture with section 115, again saying that persons who attempt to commit suicide and are saved need not be treated into the bracket of accused. Instead, they can be classified into the category of stressed persons, and they need care and love. So my friends, winding up this, rather concluding this webinar, I thank you all for the patient hearing. Thank you for being there. Stay safe, stay home.
There are some questions. Okay, so the first question is, so yes. Section 309 states that whosoever attempts to commit suicide shall be punished with imprisonment. But what if the person who tried to commit suicide manages to survive and he tried to commit suicide because of some pressure from someone else? So who will be punished?
In that case, if he survives, and first of all, he could not be punished now as per the Mental Illness Act. He would have to be treated in the category of stress persons. But if he is able to make out a case, once he survives that I was being harassed by this man with concrete evidence, then an FIR for that section, for that harassment or for that sections could be lodged, and subsequently the law would take its course. But the person who saved cannot go to jail with Mental Illness Act being coming into force.
So the next question is there any section like 113A for a married man?
Unfortunately not. Okay. Though courts have been on and often saying, right from Rupali Devi to Nikita and everybody, that 498A is a misuse section, right from Satvinder Kaur 1995 to the latest judgment of Honorable Andhra Pradesh High Court. That 498 is a misuse section. Unfortunately, men still don't have a blanket anticipatory order in such kind. That if they are harassed by their wives, what is the remedy? The remedy is personal issues to be solved with your wives.
Okay. So the next question is, will protest by way of fast unto death attract section 309?
Okay. Protest by way of fast is called as Santharayana in the Jain religion. So the moment administration comes to know that a revered monk or respected monk or any person is doing fast unto death, the basic job and the primary job of the administration as per Nikhil Soni's judgment of Division Bench of Rajasthan High Court is that to stop that fast unto death and bring and make the person eat something. But he cannot be arrested. Santhara is banned, completely banned. The practice of Santhara or fast into death is completely bad.
So, whether the pressure of study to children by student would amount to abetment of suicide by parents?
See, this is parallelly asking that if farmers died due to non-payment of loan, can entire government machinery be roped in for 306? Ultimately, as your question was, that if due to the pressure of studies, a child takes a drastic step, this is no abatement, there is no mens rea, no parent would ever dream that his child would commit suicide. Ultimately, the child takes the pain of dying, but leaves the pain forever in the parent's heart. They have to grieve through their entire life.
And if the pressure is from peer students?
But I have not come across any such judgment or any such study where due to the death of a child of studies that the parents have been roped in for an abatement of suicide. Unless there is something more to it. Unless the child was being assaulted, treated cruelly, not given proper care, attention, food, and was being hit miserably. Then possibly yes, but not only because of the pressure of studies, an offense of 306 could be made out. If it's made out, that FIR cannot see the light of the day. It is bound to be stayed and quashed ultimately.
Okay. So the next question is, whether a suicide note be treated as dying declaration during the trial? If the deceased records in a live video of his suicide, writes a chit disclosing facts regarding her death, then whether it will be termed as dying declaration?
All right. Can I answer this question in two parts? One, in my next webinar, which is purely on dying declaration, where I'll be covering this topic. Second, as you said, live. A great politician, Edward Ayers of New York, was charged with a bribery scandal. And at that time, he was a governor of that state. He came in a press conference and said that I would prove my innocence in this way. And in a press conference, he shot himself and read and thereafter he, in his pocket was suicide note was found, which says that some people have aided and abetted to see that I lose my governor's post and have falsely implicated me. But ultimately, no case of suicide was made out because the charge that he was an innocent was ultimately tested at the time of trial. So if a person goes live with a suicide note in our Indian laws, if a person goes live with a suicide note and blame somebody. First in point of time, the FIR would be launched. But ultimately, the factors that whether the suicide note stood the test of abetment, incitement, instigation, and mens rea would be scrutinized. Though initially, because of media coverage, the judiciary would be cautious. But ultimately, law would take its course. If there is a abetment, definitely the accused would be punished.
So the next question is, if charge sheet is filed for 309 IPC and plea has been pleaded not guilty, how to plead under section 115? Can I file application under 115 Mental Health Act?
No. Please come back to your question.
If charge sheet is filed for 309 IPC and plea has been pleaded, pleaded not guilty, how to plead under section 115? Can I file application under 115 of Mental Health Act?
See, there is a case which was decided by Punjab and Haryana High Court in Lokesh's case. Somewhere in 2007, Lokesh versus State of Haryana, if I'm correct, I stand corrected to this, where a conviction under 309 in an appeal was challenged before the Punjab and Haryana High Court. Punjab and Haryana High Court, while setting aside the conviction, observed that such cases, the court should be very, very cautious. At that time, the Mental Illness Act of 2017 was not in picture, but Gyan Kaur judgment was in picture. So the Punjab and Haryana High Court Division Bench, while laying down guidelines and rules for trials of such cases by the magistrate, observed that the court should be lenient and as far as possible, the punishment should be till the rising of the courts. And they should be referred to psychiatrists or people who can care and love them.
Okay. So with this, we come to an end of a session. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us on today's topic. It was indeed a pleasure and very informative session for all of us. And I'm sure it will help us uplift in our profession to new heights.
Thank you.
We look forward to having more sessions from you, sir.
Thank you. God bless.